प्रदीप
शुरू कर साउंड चेक, एम आई ऑडिबल?
यस सर, यू आर ऑडिबल सर.
ऑलराइट, अ वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल ऑफ यू. फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल आई वुड लाइक टू वेलकम ब्रिगेडियर अजित श्रीवास्तव टू टुडेस वेबिनार एंड अ लॉट ऑफ कैडेट्स आर पार्ट ऑफ दिस वेबिनार एंड I'd like to start by thanking the principal, Sainik School Satara, vice principal, and the staff who have made this possible. And dear cadets of Sainik School Satara and Purulia, I'd like to introduce Brigadier Ajit Srivastava to all of you. Well, as the country is celebrating its 75th year of independence, we thought it would be appropriate for all of you to listen to talks by people who have served the nation with pride and valor. And in this series of talks, today we have Brigadier Ajit Srivastava. Sir was commissioned in the Engineering Corps of the Army in December 1975. He then completed, after completing 2 years of training at the Indian Military Academy. After a meritorious service of 38 years in the Army, he retired on 30th April 2011. A highly qualified officer, he has done civil engineering from the College of Military Engineering, Pune, and also has done PG in structures. Sir also has a PG diploma in computer application. And he is a member of various engineering institutions like the Indian Building Congress, Indian Road Congress, and is fellow of Institution of Engineers, and also happens to be a chartered engineer. And he possesses numerous military qualifications and also has done the commando course. In his glorious service spanning 38 years, he has served every Indian border and has gone across the span of the lengths and breadths of the country. Sir has a wide experience almost in all fields, and he has also participated in combats, insurgency, and counterinsurgency, and also anti-terrorist operations in J&K. Sir has also been instrumental in the construction of tracks leading to China, Pakistan, Kargil sector, and Myanmar borders. And also has constructed a number of temporary bridges, shelters, and bunkers for our troops. Sir has also been a part of flood relief operations in UP, Assam, Andhra, etc. It is pertinent to note here that Sir has planned detailed power and water supply at CH and Glacier region, the first of its kind at an altitude over 12,000 feet, and it is the present lifeline for our Jawans in that particular region. And he was also involved in modernization of infrastructure for Central Ordnance Depot at Agra and Jabalpur. Sir has been awarded as a major. He had constructed the highest aviation base in Asia in a record time despite several climatic conditions and adverse situations. This enabled Indian Army established base to feed troops based on CH and Glacier. And for this commendable task, he was awarded by the GOCNC Northern Command. And we all are aware of the Indian Military Academy or Indian Naval Academy at Kerimala in Kerala. And it is pertinent to mention here that Brigadier Ajit Srivastava, when he was the chief engineer in Kerala, he was the one who was instrumental in construction of the entire academy. And it has been awarded by the Indian Building Congress as the best architectural structure. After his retirement, he has been involved in various activities. His hobbies include painting, woodwork, and he's also an avid motorist and involved in social work as well. Sir is the president of Akhil Bharatiya Sainik Seva Parishad of Konkan region, and he's also associated with Sri Satya Sai Sanstha. Sir happens to be a Rotarian as well, and is the secretary of the Rotary Club of Miraru. And sir has given number of talks in civil setup schools and colleges, and has motivated various cadets to join the armed forces of the India. His family includes his wife Sujata, who's a MABA, and he has two sons and like a true soldier. Both the sons are serving in the armed forces. His elder son, Lieutenant Colonel Siddharth Srivastava, is serving in the army, and younger son is with the Air Force. He is being commander Gautam Srivastava. With this introduction, I'd like to request Brigadier Ajit Srivastava to speak to our cadets. Over to you, sir.
Thanks. Thanks a million. Right. At the very onset, on the occasion of the Diamond Jubilee of Sainik School, Purulia, please do accept my heartfelt congratulations and best wishes to Group Captain Prabhakar, his staff, and all the students and their families. Good morning, everyone. I feel privileged and honored to speak with this wonderful schools, Sainik School, Purulia of West Bengal, and Sainik School, Satara. On the subject of Kargil, Operation Vijay reignited. You all are aware, India has never invaded any other country or forced war on them, as we are all known for this. It is not because the armed forces or the leadership aren't capable of doing it. It is not in our culture. Armed forces are disciplined organizations with high morale. But when someone attacks the country, we don't shy away. We fight back with vigor and selflessly for the nation. History speaks for us during the Alexander invasion, Shivaji during Aurangzeb's invasion, and the latest surgical strike. One such was Kargil Operation Vijay. We need to remember all those martyrs for their bravery, for their tenacity, for their determination, for their dedication and high morale. Kargil was a limited war, first of its kind, fiercest battle ever fought by India. It was just a few months back when India and Pakistan had tested their nuclear weapon, and the war took place despite the fact that only a couple of months before, both the nations had signed the Lahore Declaration, a declaration that recognizes the principle of building an environment of peace and security, a declaration that the issues, bilateral issues, were to be resolved by mutual agreement. The situation then was very adverse. Amidst sub-zero temperature, high altitude of 17,000 feet and above, fierce winds, enemy well-entrenched, well-equipped, perched on the dominating heights with latest weapons, with state-of-art jammers and interceptors, and with night vision devices. Contrary to the Indian armed forces, who were, as per the rule, as per the convention, in the winter posture, courageously fought the war for almost 60 days. Two major battles, Battle of Tololing, 0.5140, and Battle of Tiger Hill, 0.4875 were the turning point and the final nail in the Pak's coffin. Incidentally, warriors are not born. They are made by the Indian Army. Right. Let me quickly orient you all to where exactly Kargil is to revise your geography. I'll start clockwise, starting from south. We have Jammu and Kashmir. Jammu is shown in yellow color. White is Srinagar. The green is Pak-occupied Kashmir. The gray color is area ceded to China illegally by Pakistan. The Siachen, the Askai Chin, and the beige color is Ladakh. Kargil and Dras are as shown. You all may have or may not have visited Kargil, but let me apprise you, it is the second largest town which is there in Ladakh. The mountain ranges from 18,000 feet, from 8,000 to 18,000 feet, vertical climb, absolutely tiring and hazardous. One needs acclimatization as oxygen level there is just 9%. And even at some places less than, and what we need is 21% of oxygen. So one thus pants for the breath, obviously because of the altitude. The climate, both summer and winter, are very low. It ranges from -5 to -20 degrees centigrade. And the snow which accumulates over there is to the tune of 20 to 30 feet. Movement becomes absolutely difficult. The highest, coldest inhabited area is Dras in the world. As far as food is concerned, one really doesn't feel hungry at that altitude. Believe you me, even if you have to eat banana, even if you have to eat oranges, you have to literally boil them. The demography of that place of Kargil, it consists of 95% Muslim population, 4.5% of Buddhist, and just 0.5% are others. Being closer to the line of communication, the mountains dominate the entire road communication, and it's vulnerable to observation and fire. Now, this is the post 5353, which was occupied by Pakistan, and you can see the road from Srinagar to Kargil can be observed by them. Now imagine if they captured Tiger Hill, the entire stretch of road can be dominated both by fire as well as observation throughout the night. Now let's see why Pakistan ventured into attacking Kargil area. Now during, I would like to just bring to your notice that General Musharraf, this was a brainchild of General Musharraf. He happened to be as a major in this sector. Later as a brigadier, he commanded a brigade there. So obviously he knew the area inside out, and that is where he ventured into this war. First and foremost, the aim of them was to basically cut off the Kashmir and Ladakh from the rest of the country. Secondly, he wanted the army, Indian army, which was there based at Siachen to be withdrawn. Thirdly, he wanted the settlement of borders of J&K to be brought to the table and discussed. And also he wanted to internationalize this particular issue of Kashmir. Lastly, raise the morale of the Pakistani infiltrators who were sent into the valley. And lastly, to arouse the Muslim rebel who were there fighting in the name of Islam. Now, let me explain you this particular map, which is there. What you see here is LOC in red. the line of control. Pakistan, the POK is on the northern side, and the Kargil, India, is on the southwest, southeast side. We have the National Highway NH1 running all along, and in the Dras sector, it is the closest near the Tiger Hill. It is the closest to the LOC. The Kargil area was divided into four subsectors: the Batalik subsector, the Kaskar subsector, the Dras subsector, and the Moscow Valley subsector. Now, what happens is, it has been going on since ages that during winters, because of this inclement weather, because of this climatic conditions and this heavy snowfall, maintenance of the troops at these height level becomes difficult. So it was decided long time back, and it was being followed as a convention, to resort to winter posture. Now, in winter posture, what happens is both the troops withdraw to lower heights. But because of this idea of General Mushrif, he decided to launch an offensive, which was called as Operation Badr. During winters of 98-99, Mushrif inducted troops, hard-trained troops, and paramilitary forces in the garb of Mujahideens, what they called them as Mujahideens. The Pak troops were also there. They not only inducted the troops, they inducted all arms, ammunition, anti-aircraft guns, the rations, the stores, whatever was required was inducted by them. Heavy artillery equipment and others, including the sophisticated equipment, weapon system, and your night vision devices, these were all pumped in. They also started constructing bunkers during the post-winter, when there was nobody was supposed to be there. They made the bunkers, and by the end of winter, they had already plonked themselves comfortably well-clothed. We'll just go through this video.
बेहद ऊंचाई पर बैठे दुश्मन की स्थिति इतनी अनुकूल थी कि 10 घुसपैठिए हजार सैनिकों की टुकड़ी पर भारी पड़ रहे थे, और अगर ऐसे में उनके पास भारी तादाद में मशीन गन, हल्की तोपे, स्ट्रिंगर मिसाइल्स और एंटी एयरक्राफ्ट गन हो, तो आप समझ सकते हैं कि खतरा कितना बढ़ गया था। ऐसे में जमीनी लड़ाई सैनिकों की बलि चढ़ाते जाने से ज्यादा कुछ साबित नहीं होती, लिहाजा दुश्मनों को उनकी ही मान में मार गिराने का एक ही तरीका था, और वो थी एयर स्ट्राइक्स। लेकिन उसमें भी खतरा था, जवाबी कार्रवाई जंग के दायरे में आ सकती थी। बेहद ऊंचाई पर बैठे
Now, during February, March, or April, once the season opened up, the shepherds took their sheep onto the mountain ranges for cattle grazing, for sheep grazing. And that is where they noticed some movement on top. And they realized that they were not the Indian, they were Pakistani troops. And accordingly, they informed the authorities. Unfortunately, no cognizance was taken place. But still, when they informed the Pakistani authorities about this, they refused flatly. Ke bhai, ye hum log nahi hain, ye aapke jihadis hain. Army did not wait for that. They inducted Lieutenant Kalia along with six jawans to carry out the patrolling in the Jubar sector, which is there, that is Batalik subsector. The climb was absolutely hazardous. It was cold. They were not totally equipped, ready for that. They didn't know where exactly the Chinese, where exactly these troops would be. And they continued to climb over the day. And when they took a break for meal, they were suddenly pounced by the Pakistanis. They were captured, made POWs, and they were butchered. Their body parts were cut to pieces, eyes gouged out. It was confirmed to the Pakistanis that army has already been alerted. So what they did immediately was they started bombarding. And they bombarded on 9th May the ammunition dump, which was there in Kargil sector. as also they started inducting their more troops, about 60 to 80 of them in Moscow Valley and 80 to 100 of them in Kaskar sector, they inducted onto the post, constructed all the bunkers and were ready to take on of any offensive coming from the army side. The Air Force sorties were sent out on 11th May, the Canberra, and they identified and reported that 250 Pakistanis were seen in Moscow Valley, 2 to 250 were seen in Batalik sector, and approximately 100 were waiting in the depth areas. Unfortunately, one of these Canberra was shot down by them. The area being mountainous, it was very difficult to really find the target, yet they did a marvelous job. Indian Air Force continued to shell fight against the Pakistani despite the odd situation of mountainous areas, and they were not able to really see the target, yet they pounced them. I would like to just tell you, had Pakistani used the Air Force, things would have been totally different. They continued to shell the NHAI, National Highway, and we asked the Indian troops to be inducted from Srinagar. They were not acclimatized. Srinagar is at a lower height. They were not acclimatized. Now, I'll just tell you, when you come from Srinagar towards Kargil side, you have to cross Sonmarg. It's a hilly region. The traffic plies only one way. No two traffic up and down are separate days and separate timings. The roads are narrow and they are not proper roads. They're kacha track, kacha roads, because of the landslides. Any miscalculations during day would result in accident down into the valley, thousands of feet, unrecoverable. Now imagine these troops had to move from Srinagar towards Dras sector under the nose of the Pakistani who were already plonked, who could see. And if you recollect, even Tiger Hill, which was captured by them, they could see it. So therefore, they had to move in during night time, literally crawl without lights. So it took them a lot of risk. Unfortunately, there was never, an accident. They all crawled slowly and reached on top in mid-May. Then have a view of it.
पाकिस्तान की ओर से गोले बेहद सही जगह और सही समय पर गिर रहे थे। हालात नाजुक देख भारत ने भी अहम जगहों पर बड़ी तोपें तैनात कर दी। इसके अलावा पाक हमले की सही जानकारी के लिए टोही विमान उड़ाए गए, ज्यादा पेट्रोल पार्टी रवाना की गई। पता चला कि मशको से बटालिक के बीच पहले 120 किलोमीटर के दायरे में घुसपैठियों ने कई जगह अपने बंकर बना लिए हैं। त्रास, काशकर, बटालिक, मशको में 10 किलोमीटर तक घुस आए थे घुसपैठिए। करगिल से उत्तर की ओर 80 किलोमीटर के क्षेत्र में आतंकियों ने ऊंची पहाड़ियों पर अड्डे बना लिए थे। उनके निशाने पर था ये हाईवे। हाईवे इसलिए क्योंकि लेह को श्रीनगर से जोड़ने वाली सामरिक महत्व की इस सड़क को बंद कर पाकिस्तान सर्दियों में लद्दाख को जाने वाली आपूर्ति रोक सकता था। द्रास और करगिल पर कब्जा करके उसे नियंत्रण रेखा खुलवाने के लिए इस्तेमाल कर सकता था। चुग घाटी, बटालिक और तुर्तुक क्षेत्र की पहाड़ियों पर कब्जा करके भारत को सियाचिन से पीछे हटने पर मजबूर कर सकता था। करगिल के पास मशको घाटी के नालों पर कब्जा करके वहां से ताजा घुसपैठ के लिए रास्ते बना सकता था, पर सबसे बड़ा मंसूबा था नियंत्रण रेखा को बदलने और शिमला समझौते को दफन कर कश्मीर को फिर से अंतर्राष्ट्रीय मंच पर लाने का।
जब तक हम हाईवे को क्लियर नहीं करते और उनका जो इन्फ्लुएंस हाईवे के ऊपर बम गोलाबारी हम उसको बंद नहीं करते, तो हमारी कॉन्वॉयज जो थी वो कश्मीर से लद्दाख की तरफ, श्रीनगर से कारगिल या लेह की तरफ जानी मुश्किल थी, और लड़ाई के बीच में हम लोग उनको भेजते थे पर रात के समय के ऊपर और थोड़ा थोड़ा करके। लेकिन जैसे ही हमने उनका इन्फ्लुएंस हाईवे से हटा दिया, उनको दूर भगाया वहाँ से, तो फिर कम्युनिस्ट।
Between 1st June to 5th June, heavy shelling continued by the Pakistani. And fortunately, on 5th June, in the Batalik subsector, some Pakistani troops were killed and their identities were found out that they were from Pakistan's 12 North Light Infantry troops. Now, this information was therefore shared with the environment, with Americans and with the others. Pakistan continued shelling and in Kargil sector on 6th June launched an offensive. Two posts in the Jobar sector, in Jobar area, were captured on 9th of June. Now, fortunately, Indian Army was able to intercept the conversation between Chief of Army Staff Musharraf, who was sitting in China, and Chief of General Staff, Lieutenant General Aziz Khan, taking stock of what was happening, which clearly revealed that this was an operation by them and not by the jihadis of which they had earlier claimed. The Air Force continued firing. Two main areas, the key areas, were Tololing feature as well as Tiger Hill. Now, Tololing had basically a massive feature which had a 0.5140. Now, on 12th June, after twice being repulsed in that height, the Indian Army was able to engage footholds. Now, this is what the Tololing feature is. The entire thing was Tololing feature. And this is the Tololing top. And this is the 0.5140. Now, you can imagine climbing on this with Pakistani posts with night vision devices during night at that altitude where the oxygen itself is less was very difficult. Despite that, you obviously couldn't go during daytime. Despite that, the Indian Army managed to establish a foothold on Tololing top. What was left now is the key point 5140, which was absolutely steep. There was only one axis to reach on top. And obviously three bunkers were poised there, pointing their weapons directly on that approach. Any movement would take a pot shot on them, plus night vision devices added to this. It was here. Now, this is the model which is there. It seems it what you see here is rather gentle, but actually it was what I showed in the others earlier slide was absolutely steep. Now, during night, you had to go along this axis only. It was here that Lieutenant Batra's team was inducted. Now, on 18th itself, this portion of hump was captured in the night. Pakistani expected that they will regroup and then probably launch an attack the next night, but it didn't happen so. Lieutenant Batra and his troops launched an offensive on this point, 5140. 5140 is approximately 17,000 feet high. So the area was absolutely without any cover. You couldn't have gone onto the left side or right side, otherwise you'll go into the valley. So you had to perforce crawl over that place. Now what happens is, before any attack, the artillery opens up fire. In the plain area, it is taken off at 400 meters before the art troops reach the target. In mountains, it is reduced to 200. It was here, the moment the Pakistani heard these what you call shelling coming from the Indian artillery, they realized the moment the shell would be stopped, the Indian army would attack. So they opened up, they're firing vigorously. Now it was here that Lieutenant Batra decided to continue the firing till they reach 100 meters short of their target, which originally is supposed to be 200 meters, thereby risking themselves of getting splinters of the shells. Notwithstanding that, the moment they reached there, shelling was stopped when they reached the target 100 meters short. He moved in, lobbed a grenade, had a hand-to-hand fight, and captured two of the three bunkers. The third bunker was therefore silenced by the rest of the troops. And one more officer, Jamwal, was there, and he also assisted in capturing it. And therefore, this particular post, the key post, which was the turning point, was captured in the night. Incidentally, all these offenses had taken place during nighttime. On 18th, the India could host a flag on this particular feature. Lieutenant Batra, because of his outstanding thing, the Chief of Army Staff, General Malik, immediately promoted him to the rank of captain. And the Batra top was named after him, as the tolling that 0.5140 was thereby named as Batra top. The enemy which was sitting there, the Pakistanis who were sitting there, were finally evicted from Tololing area. Now, what was left was only Tiger Hill, which was the second most key feature.
तोलोलिंग में जो कुछ चल रहा था उसे सुन सुनकर लेफ्टिनेंट बत्रा और उनके साथियों का खून खौल रहा था। वो रणभूमि में उतरने के आदेश के लिए छटपट आ रहे थे। 19 जून को वो दिन भी आ गया जब जवानों को कूच करने का फरमान सुनाया गया। लेफ्टिनेंट विक्रम बत्रा और कैप्टन संजीव जामवाल को दो टुकड़ियों की कमान सौंपी गई और एक बेहद कठिन मिशन का ऐलान कर दिया गया। ते बीत चुके थे, लेकिन अभी दुश्मन की स्थिति बेहतर थी। भारतीय फौज को जीत तो हासिल हो रही थी, लेकिन ऐसी कोई निर्णायक बढ़त नहीं थी जिससे युद्ध में जीत का रास्ता दिखे। पीक 5140 तोलोलिंग दर्रे की सबसे ऊंची चोटी है। अगर दुश्मन वहां से साफ हो जाए तो अपनी पहाड़ियों पर वापस नियंत्रण का रास्ता खुल जाता है, लेकिन ये चोटी जितनी महत्वपूर्ण है उस पर फतेह उतना ही मुश्किल है। पहाड़ चट्टानी है और चढ़ते वक्त किसी तरह का कोई कवर नहीं। दुश्मन की नजर पड़ते ही वो तोप तान देता। अमूमन ऐसी फायरिंग को तब रोक दिया जाता है जब सैनिक 400 मीटर के दायरे में पहुंच जाते हैं, पर यहां आदेश थे कि सैनिक जब तक दुश्मन के बंकर के 200 मीटर करीब न पहुंच जाएं, तब तक तोप चलते रहे। पाकिस्तान को भी शक हो चला था कि भारत की ओर से जरूर कोई कार्रवाई हो रही है, इसीलिए जैसे ही आर्टिलरी ने फायरिंग बंद की वैसे ही दुश्मन बंकरों से बाहर आकर गोलियां बरसाने लगा। तब लेफ्टिनेंट बत्रा और कैप्टन जामवाल ने वो फैसला लिया जो उनके खुद के लिए बेहद घातक हो सकता था। उन्होंने कहा कि जब तक वो 100 मीटर के दायरे में नहीं पहुंच जाते, गोलाबारी जारी रहे।
वो लोग ऊंचाई पर थे सब, और आप जानते हैं ये सारी नाइफ रिजेस हैं, बहुत ही बारीक, डिप्लॉयमेंट के लिए ज्यादा जगह नहीं है। तो अगर आपने और बहुत स्टीप क्लाइम्स हैं और कवर नहीं है जिसके पीछे आड़ के पीछे आप कुछ अपने आप को बचा सके।
चोटी के दो तरफ से दुश्मन के बंकरों पर लेफ्टिनेंट बत्रा और कैप्टन जामवाल की कंपनियां टूट पड़ी। लेफ्टिनेंट विक्रम बत्रा ने आगे बढ़ते हुए पहले बंकर में ग्रेनेड उछाला और फिर दूसरे की ओर लपके। इस युवा अफसर की दिलेरी देखकर उनके सैनिकों में जोश भर चुका था।
Now, once this incident took place, and it was known to the world that this is what is happening in the Kargil sector, the President of America, Bill Clinton, he rang up Prime Minister of Pakistan, Nawaz Sharif, and asked him to immediately withdraw from this particular place, because adequate proofs were already sent about the involvement of the Pakistan Army, as well as the intercept of Chief of Army Staff of Pakistan, General Musharraf, and the conversation was sent to them. And that is where they asked them to withdraw. The Captain Batra was then tasked to move down towards Tiger Hill area. In the meantime, two of the posts in the Tiger Hill were finally captured. What was left now? The last post, Tiger Hill. On 2nd July, the Indian Army launched a three-pronged attack simultaneously in Batalik subsector, in Kaksar subsector, and in Moscow Valley and Dras subsectors, containing the entire enemy all over the front, because the troops had already fetched up. The artillery guns have also fetched up, and they could sustain this particular attack. What was left was now only one Tiger Hill. On 4th July, the attack on Tiger Hill went, which is 0.4875, approximately 16,000 plus feet. The Tiger Hill was a very steep feature. The excess were obvious, and they were all with the Pakistani guns trained over those approaches. They couldn't have gone there. The on one side was a vertical cliff, almost about 1,000 feet. A 1,000 feet, if you can just imagine, is as good as 100-storied building. Now, this is where the 18 Grenadiers Sipai, Yoginder Singh Yadav, he, along with his commando troops, climbed up, scaled that complete vertical wall all throughout the night. And having reached on top, despite being so cold, the stones were ice cold, yet they managed to climb up with whatever material they had, whatever winter clothing they had. They scaled on top, reached on top, crawled over to the China, on the Pakistanis' bunkers, and had a hand-to-hand fight. Though Yoginder Singh was inflicted with 16 bullets, yet he fought and captured. This silenced a lot of bunkers on top, and Captain Batra, along with his troops, moved up, crawling there with no cover, with heavy firing from the Pakistani side, in with their luggage of almost 25. I remember one of them had mentioned that he shed off his food, 2 kg food, and replaced it with ammunition, 100 rounds of ammunition to fight out, because khana to baad mein bhi mil sakta hai, lekin ammunition ki zarurat thi. So they sacrificed to that extent, crawled and captured those bunkers. Now, unfortunately, one of his subaltern, Captain Batra's subaltern, got injured. Having almost captured all the bunkers, he came and rescued him, lifted him, and tried to take him to a safer position. It was here that even he got shot by one of the hidden Pakistani soldier. By then, the flag was of Indian flag was already flaring on the Tiger Hill. It was captured. We'll just have a quick look at the video of this. The Pakistanis were finally evicted.
Called Khatak platoons, performed awe-inspiring acts of bravery and fiercely defended India's borders with every last drop of their blood. One of these commandos is Subedar Yugendra Singh Yadav, who was awarded the country's highest gallantry award, the Paramveer Chakra.
For... 16,500 feet.
The approach to the top of the hill was steep, rocky, and extremely dangerous. Grenadier Yogendra Yadav, unmindful of the danger involved, volunteered to lead and fix the rope for his team to climb up. But the enemy spotted them.
उन्होंने दोनों तरफ से ऐसे फायरिंग खोल दिए, जो हमारी टुकड़ी का रास्ता था वो कट अप हो गया।
And they opened intense fire, killing the commander and two of his colleagues. Grenadier Yogendra Singh Yadav was also seriously injured, but he did not give up. He continued crawling up to the enemy position, even though his body was riddled with bullets. He finally reached the top, lobbing grenades and firing at the enemy. He killed four enemy soldiers in close combat and finally silenced their automatic fire. Inspired by his gallant act, his platoon charged in the other positions with renewed fervor and captured Tiger Hill.
उन्नीस 1999 को 0.4875 पर कब्जा करने के लिए आगे बढ़े और जब वे 7 जुलाई को 0.4875 पर कब्जा करने के लिए आगे बढ़े तब अचानक पाकिस्तानी सैनिकों ने अंधाधुंध फायरिंग शुरू कर दी और जब कैप्टन बत्रा ने देखा कि उनके साथी डेंजर जोन में हैं तो वे तेजी से पाकिस्तानी सैनिकों की ओर शेर की तरह टूट पड़े और उन्हें मौत के घाट उतार दिया और इस दौरान कैप्टन बत्रा ने कई सारे दुश्मनों को मार गिराया। ये मिशन भी लगभग पूरा हो चुका था लेकिन इसी बीच कैप्टन बत्रा की नज़र अपने जूनियर साथी लेफ्टिनेंट नवीन पर पड़ी जो कि एक विस्फोट में बहुत बुरी तरीके से जख्मी हो गया था और इसी बीच विक्रम बत्रा जब अपने साथी को कंधे पर लेकर आगे की ओर बढ़ ही रहे थे तभी एक छिपे हुए पाकिस्तानी सैनिक की गोली उनकी छाती में आ लगी लेकिन इसके बावजूद उन्होंने अपने साथी को सुरक्षित जगह पहुंचाया और बचे पाकिस्तानियों पर टूट पड़े और अपनी आखिरी सांस लेने से पहले वे तिरंगा लहरा चुके थे और शहीद होने से पहले कैप्टन बत्रा के आखिरी शब्द थे जय।
Thus, on 5th July, the Draz was also under control. We had captured this particular feature, which was the main turning point. Now, what was left was just one small in the Batalik subsector, that is Jubber Heights. In the meantime, on 5th July, Prime Minister of Pakistan had announced that the Pakistan army to withdraw from Kargil following the meeting with the and the directions from Bill Clinton. On 7th July, that last post of Jubber Heights, which was there under Lieutenant Manoj Pandey, was sent for the attack. And it was a very difficult and ferocious attack where they finally evicted the Pakistani troops. And in that incident, even Manoj Pandey lost his life. On 11 July, finally, the Pakistanis were thrown out from the Kargil sector. Now, here I would like to bring out that once this war was over, the Pakistanis, since they took a stand that they were not at all involved, they were jihadis, left their troops. The identity cards proved that they were Pakistani troops who were there, regular Pakistani troops. They did not bother to take their bodies back. It was here that the Indian Army, as per their culture, as per their tradition, carried out their burials with proper honors, with religious honors, with one of the Indian troops who was a Muslim in there. He did the entire ritual for them. We'll just go through a video of this. The Tiger Hill and other areas were captured. The final flag was already unfurled from the top. The Pakistanis being evicted. And like I said, they did not bother to pick up their soldiers. Pakistani flags were brought up and their bodies were covered up. And the burial took place subsequently. The troops were pulled up from the bottom, from the other places where they were there. Thank you. These are the Pakistani troops. This is a gentleman who was there. This is a soldier who was a Muslim. He carried out the rituals. Now imagine at that particular height, to dig even the ground which was solid, rocky, was a tough job. Yet whatever they could do, they did the burial, and they did it ceremoniously, religiously.
Today, we're carrying out the burial of 7 Pakistani soldiers who have laid down their life in combat here as a mark of respect to the soldiers who have died.
You can just see the amount of ammunition and the weaponry system which was carried by them during the winters prior to the Kargil war. The feature, the difficult terrain.
That was vacated by the enemy, our troops have recovered large quantity of ammunition, equipment, and 825 anti-personnel mines. 56 killed, 696.
If Pakistan doubts them, it is for their representatives to come and see the bodies. We have not yet received a response from Pakistan through the ICRC. It is very clear that Pakistan is fully aware of the identities of these bodies, but they do not wish to acknowledge this fact, as it would immediately expose the army's involvement in Kargil.
Wounded 584.
Finally, on 14 July, Prime Minister Atal Bihari Vajpayee declared that this operation was a success. And by 26 July, he confirmed that all Pakistanis were evicted from the Kargil sectors. Just little data, Indian Army, about 2 lakhs were involved. This was a battle which was fought at the battalion and regiment level, unlike 65 and 71 war, where we fought the entire Indian Army, Air Force and Navy were all involved in it. Here only it was done at a battalion level. About 3,000, 30,000 soldiers were there in the military operation in the Kargil and Dras sectors alone itself. And the peak conflict, Pakistan had 5,000, including their logistics, since they were perched on top. And we lost about 527 and 1,363 were injured. Now, Operation Safed Sagar, which was done by the Indian Air Force, this was the first time where they had launched such an offensive in the hilly area. They lost 4 of them, aircrafts, but 5,000 sorties was done in 60 days' time. The targets were too difficult, and despite that, they were able to pinpoint certain places and do it. Now, one would wonder how Navy was involved in Kargil war. This was something surprising. People always say, okay, what Navy has to do in that particular area was the job of only Air Force and Army. But Navy played a major role also in truncating this war. They blockade in the Karachi harbor, carried out aggressive patrols, resulted in cutting off the fuel supply to Pakistan and other equipment and other, trade requirements which were there. And as a result, the Prime Minister of Pakistan, Nawaz Sharif, finally disclosed that they were just left because of this blockade only 6 days of fuel in entire country. Obviously, they couldn't have sustained this war further. Navy played a major role. Lastly, I would fail in my duties if I do not talk about the war heroes. The first was Captain Vikram Batra, the Paramveer Chakra, which was awarded posthumously. I will just like to tell you, He was to get married before he was coming for this operation, but he said, no, I'll come back and I'll then get married. Incidentally, that girl who was to get married and engaged to him is still a spinster. She has not got married. And before leaving, the words of Atra were, either I will come back after hoisting the tricolor, or I will come back wrapped in it. But I will be back for sure. Ye dil mange more. And he did come back, but wrapped in tricolor. Grenadier Yogendra Singh Yadav, who was awarded Paramvir Chakra. I'll just quote a small incident. He was the youngest person when he was 16 years, 16 and a half years, he joined the Indian Army. And at 19 years, he was there for this operation. The award was initially awarded to him posthumously because they mistook another Yogendra Singh Yadav, who was there in the same war, same battle time. They thought it is him, but later on they discovered that the actual Yogendra Singh Yadav is alive, and then it was rectified. Lieutenant Manoj Pandey, like I mentioned, in the Jubbar Heights where he had fought and he was finally lost his life there, he was awarded posthumously. Incidentally, in the case of Lieutenant Manoj Pandey, he was from Sainik School of Uttar Pradesh, and they have named on his particular name, Manoj Pandey Hall, Science Hall has been named after him. And he had this saying, he said, if death strikes before I prove my blood, I swear I'll kill death itself. Sanjay Kumar, a rifleman who assisted, who was there hand to hand, shoulder to shoulder with apne Vikram Batra, Captain Vikram Batra, was also awarded Paramvir Chakra. Incidentally, even in the case of Vikram Batra, he was selected from SSB Allahabad. And that is where their hall, the block, has been named as Captain Vikram Batra. And also, the officer's residential enclave in Jabalpur has been renamed as Captain Vikram Batra Enclave. Just a summary. In this war, there were 10 Mahavir Chakras. There were 49 Veer Chakras and 135 Sena Medals, the highest which ever in this short span was provided to them. Lastly, if you ever go to Kargil, you'll certainly find these type of flyers out there, sign postings, which says what is a lifetime adventure for you, that is for the civilians, is a daily routine for us. Our flag does not fly because the wind moves it. It flies because last breath of each soldier who died protecting it. There's in Kargil, they have made a memorial for all these, where it says only the best friends, best of the friends, and the worst of the enemies visit us. Finally, before winding up, you get nothing for free. The bill for the freedom you enjoy, these soldiers have already paid for it. Thank you so much, and Jai Hind.
Thank you so much, sir. On behalf of Sainik School Satara and Sainik School Purulia, I extend a very hearty vote of thanks, sir, to Brigadier Ajit Srivastav for sparing your valuable time. It was indeed a very intriguing tale of valor and bravery by our soldiers.
Sir, you are not audible, sir.
Not audible?
Is audible, Tingre?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Audible, sir.
Yes, sir.
Am I audible to you, sir?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, you are.
So, thank you very much, sir. It was really a very inspirational talk for all of us, because all of our cadets are aiming to join National Defense Academy and aim to become like Batra and Pandey's. And and surely with talks like this, they will have enough of inspiration and motivation to put their best efforts in joining the National Defence Academy. My compliments to you, sir, for bringing out all these facts so nicely and so interestingly. And our cadets have really learned a lot from this, and it will go a long way in motivating them and continuing their efforts for joining towards NDA. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. It's been a real pleasure of interacting with the, for sharing these things in a very diagrammatic manner, which really sinks into their head. Mere video won't have sunk into their mind. Thank you very much.
And we look forward for your visit to Sainikul Satara too, sir.
Yeah, yeah, certainly. Yeah. I've already had, this is going to be my second visit then.
Sir. We'll be very thankful to you if you come.
I'm told some questions are going to be raised.
Cadets, if you have any question, please do feel free to ask, sir. You can raise your hand and we will unmute you. Tingre, kindly unmute the cadet who wants to ask a question.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Good morning, sir.
Morning.
Sir, I cadet Vikram from 10th standard. Sir, if Air Force has been a part in the war, then it was so easy. Then why the Air Force was not part of that war?
Okay, I'll tell you the reason. Basically, Mushraf wanted to eat the cake himself. He did not inform the chief of air staff. He did not inform the chief of naval staff. They were totally ignorant about this particular offensive. The basic reason was, after that, he became the, what you call, the president of Pakistan. He did a coup and he was, the martial law was imposed, because otherwise he's going to be questioned. So that was the one of the reason why he did not keep this information, shared this information, and kept the entire thing with him itself. A selfishness, basically. You have to unmute yourself. Aditya, you have to unmute yourself.
Yes. Good afternoon, sir. Good afternoon. My name is Kaidat Aditya from Saini School, Satara.
Right.
So my doubt is, after capturing Tololing Hill, Vikram Batra was sent immediately to Tiger Hill. Why was not a break given to him?
Okay, I'll just tell you. Now, if you see the time lag, why I was showing you the time and dates was where you can gauge. That was on 18th of June. And this issue had taken place on 4th of July. There was a lot of time. Once you have captured that particular feature, you need to regroup. Now, it was not only Batra who had gone from 13 Jack. It was also 18 Grenadiers. They started regrouping. A lot of casualties had taken place. Casualty took place not only because of injuries. It was also injuries due to the climatic conditions. People were having hypothermia. People were having... So therefore, are you there?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So therefore, it was basically regrouping and doing. 13 Jack had come from Valley. The rest of the troops were already there holding their role. So these were the troops which were supposed to augment the Indian Army. So therefore, he was pulled out. It was just coincidence that he was the one of them. And since he was a daredevil, that particular unit, which was tasked to capture Tiger Hill, was obviously they sent him along with the other. There were other officers also involved in it, but he came to limelight because of this incident. And he was the final person to capture Tiger Hill.
Thank you, sir.
Boss, any other question? Any other doubts?
Yeah, there are.
Sir, I have one more doubt.
Yeah, bolye.
Sir, when the first effort, they were gone in February month, and why army was not there at the top of the hills?
Correct.
When the effort started.
Yeah. Like I said initially, that it was the convention that during winters, because the snow level is almost 20 to 30 feet, which gets accumulated, for the troop to stay there doing nothing and maintaining them was enormous. It was not only expensive, it was very difficult. So both the troops used to withdraw. This was going on since donkey's years. It was not that the army was supposed to be there. They were supposed to be down below. Like I showed you in one of the slide, winter posture. The winter posture was supposed to be done, taken. But when you have a malified intention, you break that rule. And that is what precisely Pakistani had done. They used the commandos, they used the paramilitary forces, they used the civilians or whatever they had, who were trained all throughout the winter of 1998 and then pushed in with all the arms and ammunition. So they broke the rule. And that is why the army was down below. And because we were down below, it took so much of time and you become vulnerable once the troops, once the Pakistani were perched on top. So they become vulnerable. So none of them were supposed to be there, but they had a manifest intention. So they went and occupied at that point of time.
Sir, but what was the time period?
Sorry?
Sir, what was the time period when the armies were supposed to be at the downhills?
It is normally May-June. Normally May-June is the time. That is why, if you remember, a shepherd came and reported that there is some movement going on. Because they were well clothed, Pakistanis were well clothed, well equipped, and it was planned that way. So that is where they noticed during February, that was the time when army was not supposed to be there. And that is where he was confused. Okay, how come I see movements on the top? And he reported that issue. So obviously, during February, March, May, the troops were not supposed to be there. The time the snow melts away.
Thank you, sir.
Suraj?
Good afternoon, sir.
Yeah, good afternoon. Suraj.
Sir, I'm Cadet Suraj Deshmukh from Saini School, Satara.
Yeah.
And sir, I have a doubt that it was signed. The Indian Army went for any patrol, visits or not?
See.
They did their patrolling or not?
No, they do patrolling. But they don't see, once you know that there's nobody there, you don't carry out the patrolling. You carry out patrolling on regular basis. It is done on regular basis once you reach on top. During the winter posture, nobody does patrolling. It is in this case, when the shepherds reported that there's some movement seen on top, some digging being done on top by the elements which were not supposed to be there. Because they also knew Indian Army is still down below. And during the month of May, June, they would be moving up with their rations and things like that. So that is where, to verify the correctness of that shepherd, the Lieutenant Kalia was, Captain Kalia was sent on top to find out whether what this individual has said is a truth or not. But once the Indian Army reaches on top, like as on date, when they're sitting on top, the patrolling is carried out on regular basis from post to post.
Thank you, sir. And sir, when the troops were below the, were not on the top, was the top of the hills visible from below?
See, you can't see. Can you see in Satara from standing on the ground floor, the second floor of your barracks? You can't. You have to be far away. So in the mountains, the typical feature, if you remember the photograph I had shown, they were so steep that you can't see anything. And any of the movements are always done in the nighttime. They are not done during daytime. Only daytime you can observe and plan out your activities. But at that time, nobody moves. So the movement was in night. Firstly, it was dark. Therefore, you couldn't see anything. Secondly, because of the features configuration, you couldn't see anything. It was all rocky. So you can't really make out who's sitting there or not unless you reach in the close vicinity. Thoda baat unko malum pada tha ki wahan pe hain, but then trying to shell them was again a Herculean task for artillery also, and for Air Force in particular, who were on top, but yet you can't see human beings on the mountains.
Sir, why did Indian Air Force not strike over them?
Sorry?
Sir, why did Indian Air Force not strike over them?
See, this is what exactly I told you. The Indian Air Force in the mountain area, it was very difficult for them to do that. They did 5,000 sorties. They did destroy a lot of bunkers. They did destroy them. They did, inflict injuries. But the degree of injury which is in, can be inflicted by Air Force in the plain area vis-a-vis in mountainous area is very different, is very difficult. When you have a point on top, to hit on top where the people is sitting, the shell can go beyond or it can fall short also. But in the case of plane, when the shell falls here, it inflicts over an area. So in mountain, this is the handicap for Air Force. Despite that, they carried out their operations just by losing only 4 aircraft and 5,000 sorties, and they were able to get information and inflict casualties wherever feasible. Had Pakistani used the Air Force, the story would have probably been totally different.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
And it's anybody else?
Yeah, I see. Vikrant.
He has already asked you, sir.
Achha, okay.
Yes, sir.
Then I see Suraj also has asked me.
Yes, sir.
Unless he's got something new. Yeah, Vikrant.
Sir, from how many days before the war, the Pakistani armies were settled on the top?
Sorry, how many?
How many before days from the war the Pakistani armies were settled on the top?
See, like I said, they started infiltrating during winters of 1998 and 1999. They started coming on top. They may not have come and sat down on top. They started inducting. If you recollect my slide, I have that's why I have deliberately animated so that it registers in your mind. They had started infiltrating slowly, getting the equipment. And in the month of April, May, they came and plonked over the positions which were actually to be occupied by the Indian Army. That was a surprise factor. They took the Indian Army by surprise. But because of the valor, because of the tenacity, because of the determination and morale of the Indian troops, despite being handicapped, they were able to throw them out from that particular place. See, it is not like a boxing ring, jahan pe referee ne bola box, and both of them are ready. Here, it was, they had just taken us by surprise. And especially when you have an agreement 3 months back that we will all sort out the issues mutually, then obviously it was like a stabbing on your back. And when somebody stabs in a back, you really don't know. You have to turn back and fight it. And that is precisely what the Indian Army, Indian Air Force had done.
And sir, the food for Pakistan armies, from where they get? From a naval command, from a sea area or from their route?
What?
The food for Pakistani armies.
Food?
Yes, sir.
They get from the... See, Karachi is miles away from Kargil. You have seen the map. Kargil is miles away. They don't get from the sea. They get their food, which is available down in the back, in the lower portions, lower height. In POK, from there they get the food. They don't have to get the food. They already brought in and kept it in the depth areas from where they were issuing it.
Sir, how did the Indian Army come to know that what Pervez Musharraf was telling to the Chinese officials?
Intercept. See, even we have interceptors. Whatever you must be reading in the newspaper, even nowadays, that when you send a message on WhatsApp or you send a telephone call, that is tapped. So even this, because it was from China to here, it cannot be on telephone line. It had to be wireless. And that is where the intercept was taken, found. okay, that this is what is taking. So if you have not done that, then why will you take a stock of what is happening? So that because of the intercept, we came to know.
Thank you, sir. Bishal Mukherjee.
Yes, sir. Jahin, sir. I'm Cadet Bishal Mukherjee from Sainik School, Purulia. Sir, my query is that is this policy of receding from the actual position during winter is still being continued? And if yes, then are there possibilities that Pakistan can again repeat the same what they did in 99?
Yeah, you've got a good question, good doubt. But ek bar thappad pad jata hai na, to kisi ki himmat nahi hoti uthne ke liye. And they got it nice and proper. Nobody dares to do that again because it cost them. See, to get those troops and put them there, it has cost them. And not only cost in terms of finance, it has cost them in terms of shame. It has cost them in terms of lives. They dare not venture. And in today's scenario, where your Pulwama took place and a surgical strike took place, they know they dare not do that now. In any case, we have got now more surveillance equipment. We have become more careful that these people are capable of doing such stupid things. So we are more electronically carrying out this surveillance there, not physically. Physically, it is going to be very difficult. Imagine 30 feet of snow. Agar kisi bande ko wahan rakhoge, to usko khana peena kaise pachaoge? Agar wo bimar hoge, to kaise nikaloge usko? There was no visibility of the tracks when the snow is there. If you ever get time, or I'll request, there are provisions in my organizations where we take children and taken them to Kargil also. All the children have, and the locals have been taken to Kargil, and they've been made to pick up the earth from there, sand from there, and bring and put it in their areas. Thank so you. This provision is there. I'll try to see if possible. We'll try to muster and take children and show them both the borders. Kargil ka bhi dikhaya tha, or इधर राजस्थान में भी लेके दिखाया था उन लोगों को बच्चों को लेके दिखाया सो दे गॉट मोटिवेटेड सॉ व्हाट द फॉरेन सॉइल इज
ओके सर गॉट इट थैंक यू
या
ओंकार खाकर
गुड मॉर्निंग सर
मॉर्निंग
माय नेम इज ओंकार कैडेट ओंकार खमकर सर माय क्वेश्चन इज
फ्रॉम
व्हिच वाज द
सी आई हैव गॉट टू स्कूल्स आई वुड लाइक टू नो व्हिच स्कूल
Sir, I am from Science School Satar.
Okay.
Sir, my question is, which was the first point captured by Indian Army?
Which was the first point?
Captured by Indian Army.
First point?
Yes, sir. Means,
okay. See, what I have told you are the major issue in the broad sense. There are small, small points which were captured all over the time. If I start showing those, it would take a lot of time. The Indian Army was there in the Kargil sector, Batalik subsector. So Pakistani small, small points were being captured in time to time. What I have explained to you is the in a holistic manner, in a broad manner. It is not that only these were captured. There were many more small ones captured, even in Jubber Heights, which was finally evicted in the last. Before that also, there are small, small, you know, mountain is not one. There are a lot of features in between. So small features were captured, held, then captured and held. It was done in stepwise. Like when you climb on the three-storied building, you go to the first floor. You go to the second floor. What I have explained to you is how you reached on third floor. So there are a lot of small incidences for 60 days. This was going on. A lot of shelling was done. Small, small areas were being captured.
Yeah, Aditya Kumar. Tengri, can you please unmute him? Yes.
Good afternoon, sir. My name is Aditya Kumar Singh from Sainik School. So my doubt is, after winning the Kargil war, why not our soldier move to capture POK, which is ours?
Oh. See, if I come and hit you, give a slap to you, can I come and take you home? It's a matter of policy. It depends on your parents. They don't want to do. It is a political decision to do that. See, when they entered into Kargil area itself, created a hue and cry right across the world. The American president had to intervene and tell them to get out. How can you expect us to do that? Like initially I said, it is not in our culture to invade any other country. That was not our aim. Our aim is to just retain what we have with us safely. Yes, it can be thought of, what you're saying, it can be thought of, but it is beyond my jurisdiction to say so. It is the political people who have to decide whether you want to go there or not. And then going and capturing is not so easy. It involves a lot of planning. It involves a lot of expenditure. It involves lot many things, and more important is the world opinion today. You just can't go and walk into any country and just capture it. We are not Talibans.
Sir, yeah. my dream is to capture POK and Aksai Chin.
Sir, you cannot do that. You cannot do that.
Sir, it is yours.
It will. It may be done over the years. It may be done subsequently, but we can't do it. I can't say so. It may be there in the mind of the top politicians to do that, but it may not be possible to do it overnight. It has to be planned. It has to be done deliberately. Aksai Chin is not a small place as compared to Kargil. POK is not a small place as compared to Kargil. So Kargil, we ventured because it was our area. We took it back from them. POK and Aksai Chin, they are there at the moment, not with us. When time comes, probably it will be taken. I cannot say so. We cannot decide on that.
So nowadays, China is becoming more powerful than earlier. So then how can we capture Aksai Chin?
Why not? Who says we are not getting stronger? Haven't you seen Air Force has got those new aircrafts? Navy has got new submarines, new this thing. So we all are getting. That is why it is not just going and grabbing it. There are a lot of factors which are involved in taking such actions which are there.
Aditya, we will discuss it later.
Sorry?
Last question, I mean.
Yeah, yeah.
Kumar?
Sir, with your permission, I would like to ask a question from a few of our viewers who are doing this, also attending this webinar from YouTube.
Yeah, can you say again, please?
Sir, I would like to ask you a few questions which are being asked by the cadets who are attending from YouTube. They are just typing over there.
Okay, no problem.
So one of the question is, sir, when the Pakistani army attacked us,
yeah,
why didn't our army was permitted to cross the line of control and attack their country?
See, first and foremost, we, the Tiger Hill, Tololing, Jubar Heights, they're all part of the Indian country. So, aap apni jabhi ko loge ya baad mein wahan pe jaoge. To go into the Pakistan, you need certain decisions from the hierarchy, from the top. Our first aim was to capture and throw away the enemy who had ingressed into our area. The Kargil area, wherever we went and captured, were not Pakistanis, were ours, which was taken by the Pakistani troops. So we went there and took it. And that was the instruction given to us by Atal Bihari Vajpayee. We will not go. Yes, if a signal was given, probably we could have ventured. Probably we could have done it. But again, like I said, it had to be, the decision had to be taken by the political parties, the top people who are sitting in the Delhi. Yeah.
Yeah, Sanjit Kumar, been waiting for a long time.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. So this is Sanjit Kumar from Sanjit Purulia. So my question is that, was there any support from civilian side during Kargil war?
Oh, there was tremendous support from the civilians. The entire ration, the entire ammunition can't be carried by the army itself. They were there shoulder to shoulder helping the Indian army to send the stores on top. They were not there to fight, but you need logistics support. To get your rations, to get your ammunition, the civilians were helping all throughout, even during shelling, they were there. Yeah, do I answer your question?
Sanjit,
you're mute.
You can thumbs up.
I think we'll go for the next.
Yes. Yeah, Aryadeep.
Yes, sir. Sir, I am Cadet Aryadeep Mandal from Sainik School, Purulia. Sir, yeah. My question is, sir, which is a act of most responsibility? The officer who is commanding from the guard post or the soldiers who are risking their lives and fighting during the war?
See, it is both. The officer there is basically, he has to lead. He has to set an example. He has to motivate the men whom he is commanding. So the responsibility is more with the officer, because he's got to take care of the entire platoon or entire company. Their safety is of importance, and he cannot ensure that unless he is leading them from the front. That is the quality of the Indian Army, that you lead your troops from the front. So you are more vulnerable and you have to do that. But in the bargain, that motivates the troops and they carry out their task properly. Like you have seen in the videos also. See, at that particular point of time, nobody is worried about who's doing what. It is just the desire to do what you have been tasked to. It is that burning fire in your mind of patriotism, of your nation to be saved. You don't think of anything else there. And that is what the armed forces are made of. And that is what is going to be imbibed into all of you. We find maximum people from Sainik School. Brigadier Carr, who had given a talk to you all some days back, if you all there, he is also from my unit only. So material comes from Sainik School. Yeah. Do I answer you?
Yes, sir. Got it.
Rana, any other questions?
Aryadeep. Yeah, Aryadeep.
Sir, I would like to ask one question which has been asked by one of the cadet.
Yeah, boliye.
From YouTube, sir. They are asking one question. How about giving autonomy to the Indian Armed Forces toward taking decision for thwarting attacks? Is there any powers given to the commanders who are posted in the forward area after Kargil war to take decision on their own and avoid the rules of engagement at certain level?
Yeah, absolutely right question. I remember I was there in Uri sector. And when I was facing the Pakistani, see, incidentally, they call us Pathan. So they call us Pandit and we address them as Pathans or Khans. So they used to fire at us on my place, and they told me, ke Pandit, jaake Indira Gandhi se pooch ke aao, fir fire karna. My son, who is in the Indian Army, was posted in that area where Balakot had taken place. The moment they fired one shell on the post, he fired six of them on them without asking other than his commanding officer. So, as on date, the powers have been delegated to the lower level, but without breaking the basic rule of the India, of the country, of the nation. Retaliatory attacks, yes, permitted now. Earlier, one had to think. There are many such incidences where we were not permitted. I will quote you one more. In Uri sector, in one of the bunker of Jat battalion, a Pakistani shell just came into his, knocked off his head, and he was lying dead. It took 15 days for the battalion to retaliate. They were desperate, like what you heard, Batra feeling desperate to go and attack. They were feeling desperate ke Pakistani ne unke aadmi ki gardan uda di और हमको हुकुम नहीं मिल रहा है. इट टुक 15 डेज एंड फॉर दोस 15 डेज द पाकिस्तानीज वे बैटर्ड. दे कुड नॉट गेट आउट ऑफ द बंकर फॉर 15 डेज. दे शैट देयर, दे डिड सुसू देयर, दे हैड देयर फूड इन दैट बंकर्स. बट आफ्टर 15 डेज दे केम आउट एंड दे रिटेलिएटेड. द पावर्स गिवन इन पाकिस्तान एंड द पावर्स वेस्टेड विद अस are different. Today it is a total different scenario and the Pakistanis are now aware of that. Aapne ek thappad mara, hum ek saala mukka marenge tumko. Aur marenge, kisi ko poochne ki zarurat nahi hai. The commanding officer, yes, you have to ask him. There's no doubt about it. You can't do things unilaterally. I hope I answer him.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, we have Vikrant.
Sir, we would take one last question from Vikrant. I think he's asking questions.
As many. It sir. Is my pleasure and honor to answer you people.
Boys have got charge up, sir. Thank you.
Sir, did any country help Pakistani army during war or before war?
Sorry?
Did any country help the Pakistani armies during war or before the war gets started?
See, in what form are you expecting an help? The Pakistan themselves didn't know. The Indian Air, Pakistan Air Force didn't know. The Pakistan Navy didn't know. The Pakistan Prime Minister didn't know. So the question of help doesn't come at all. Whatever help was given or whatever help was existing is what they utilized. So once your own people don't know, okay, this attack is going to take place, this offensive is going to take place, so external help ki to baat hi nahi uthti hai. No external help can be done directly to the army. It has to be done to the nation. And therefore, the prime minister of Pakistan would be in knowledge, would know how. So since none of them were involved, therefore, it was like I said, Mushraf wanted to take the credit of being powerful to take the credit of the cake. He wanted to eat the cake himself. Unfortunately, the cake was thrown on his face.
Yes. Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, with the permission of both the principal.
Yes, sir.
I would like to request for closing the webinar for today, sir. And we would like to look forward for such more motivating talks.
Absolutely.
Of course, the surgical strikes can be one of the next webinar from you.
Yes, it can be. It can be very true.
Thank you so much, sir. It was Welcome. Very enlightening.
Thank you so much. It was a pleasure being with you all and really nice to listen to the doubts of the entire students and all the success and hope to see you all in the Indian Army, Indian Navy, Indian Air Force in future. Thanks. God bless.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Pleasure.
Stingray, can we end the session?
Yes, sir. I'll end.
Thanks, Ujjwal. Thanks, Lakshmikant.
Thank you so much.
End.
See you.
Thank you.
Yeah.